Tomorrow is a total solar eclipse. Yeah, it's said that 400,000 people are coming into Dallas to observe this. They've literally declared a state of emergency because of the influx of people. How many of you are planning to watch the solar eclipse? Okay, a lot of you. Okay, good, good, good. Our staff will be outside somewhere in the parking lot. We've got the right glasses. Don't worry. We'll be watching the eclipse. Now, the whole idea of the eclipse is actually an amazing phenomenon. It's a rare occasion where the sun, the moon, the earth are in perfect alignment so that we can see this amazing thing. Now, the sun, if you didn't know this, I want to give you a little bit of just nerd out on this. The sun is 400 times the size of the moon. Yet, at the solar eclipse, the total eclipse, we're going to see the moon perfectly overlap over the sun. How? Well, because the moon is 400 times closer to the earth than the sun is. It's amazing. Now, there's a series of books and videos called The Privileged Planet that have been, also I need my TV monitor if somebody could bring it out real quick. There's a series of books and videos called The Privileged Planet, okay? And in this beautiful narration and scientific documentary, they talk about how the Earth is the only privileged planet. Not simply because there is life on this planet, but it is only from our planet that we even have the possibility of discovering the rest of the universe. Okay? It's only from here that we can even see the rest of the universe. And they especially document the total eclipses across history. And they said, if it were not for these total solar eclipses, we could not have discovered everything we have about the universe. Do you know that we didn't discover helium, the second most abundant element in all the planet, in all the universe, until 1870 during a total solar eclipse? So people are going to be studying and observing this reality tomorrow from here in Dallas. It'll be, I think, 1:40 to 1:44 p.m. at this beautiful, remarkable site. And they're saying that it's because we are in a privileged position as a planet to discover what God has made. So many scientists and so many astronomers say that days like tomorrow are signs in the sky that we didn't just happen randomly. The world wasn't just created randomly, but there is an intelligent designer who made the world. That it's a sign in the sky that the creator of the universe wants to be known. And he wants the world that he created to be discovered. So he orchestrates moments like this for our discovery of his infinite power and glory. What's amazing is God's greatest self-revelation is actually not in the sign in the sky. His greatest self-revelation is in the incarnation. Where this infinite God who made everything became a baby, a human being, a child, and he lived among us. Why? Because he didn't just want us to discover the universe he made, he wanted us to discover him. He wanted to be known, and so he became one of us. And this is what the writer of John, the disciple John, who writes the Gospel of John, he writes it like this: in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He's speaking of Jesus. In the beginning, he was there with God and was God. He was with God in the beginning, and all things were created through him, and apart from him, not one thing was created that has been created. Notice the next few verses down in verse 14, John says, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we observed his glory. The glory as the one and only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. Yes, let's say amen. That's pretty good. John, the Gospel of John, is one of the four eyewitness accounts of who Jesus is that we have from the first century. Credible resources written by people who saw Jesus, knew Jesus, so that we could learn about who Jesus is. They were inspired by the Holy Spirit, but these were real people who wrote these gospel accounts. And all of them are different, written differently. And John is the most different of all the gospels we have. John has his key emphasis in the entire gospel to emphasize on the divinity of Jesus, that he is not just a mere human being. He is God in the flesh. So, for instance, Mark begins his gospel account from Jesus' baptism onwards. Luke begins with his nativity, his birth onwards. That's a good place to start. Now, Matthew ups Luke and Mark by beginning not just at his birth, but beginning with Abraham, 2,000 years before Jesus, and he begins to trace the lineage of Jesus all the way back to Abraham. But John one-ups all of them. He says, I can take it even further back. And he doesn't just go to Abraham, and he doesn't even go to Adam. He goes all the way to the beginning of time. And John says, there at the beginning was Jesus all along. He created all that we see. He was the Word in the beginning with God, and he is the one who has dwelt among us. And John says, we beheld his glory. Just as planet Earth is a privileged planet that we can discover the glory of God in the universe, John says, I had the distinct privilege, the most privileged position in life, to behold the glory of the Son of God, full of grace and truth. All the other gospel writers, they begin to describe the nature of God's kingdom. But John leans into the nature of the King himself. He says, he is full of glory. And here's what John is saying. I've experienced it. I've seen it. But I don't want to keep this to myself. I want you to see his glory. I want you to discover his wonder, his beauty. This is too good to keep to myself. So I'm inviting you as I write this gospel to discover the glory of Jesus that we had the incredible joy of discovering. And let me tell you, there's no greater privilege than discovering the glory of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Amen. No greater joy. So how does John invite us into this? He writes this gospel comprised of seven distinct signs. John knows that Jesus has done a lot of miracles, but he chooses seven of those and calls them signs because he believes that we can experience the glory of God in Jesus through these seven signs. Now, in the other gospels, the supernatural things that Jesus does, they're called miracles. The Greek word is dunamis. There are signs and wonders or supernatural workings, and the gospel writers use the word for miracles. But John is different. He never states them as miracles, but rather he calls them signs. Not miracles, but signs. He uses the Greek word semion, not dunamis, but semion, meaning sign. So what's the difference between a miracle and a sign? Let's say you go across the world. Maybe you've had the privilege to do this, so you've seen replicas of some of the most beautiful, mind-blowing paintings in the world. Maybe it was Van Gogh's The Starry Night, and you are beholden this beautiful masterpiece, looking at the swirly skies and the dynamic colors. Maybe it was The Last Supper by Leonardo da Vinci, and you're looking at the technique, the structure of the painting and what's in it. And when we look at these masterpieces, we are beholding the wonder in them. Maybe it's Mona Lisa, and you are studying this incredible, what is now probably known as the most famous painting in all of the world, in all of history. What's amazing about these art pieces, these masterpieces, is that when we go, they are a destination. Like people travel from all over the world to go stand in front of one of these paintings and just behold the wonder that's in the painting. And we marvel and we find the beauty and the glory in the painting. That's what's common about these art pieces that you just saw. Now, I want to show you a set of different images, and I want you to tell me the difference. Okay, what's this? Okay, no one's super excited to see a sign unless you need to fill gas or you got a toddler who needs to go to the restroom. Okay, this is just a sign that points to something else. There is no wonder in and of this sign. Okay, here's another one. Again, just another sign. I've never met somebody who said, wow, would you look at how this arrow just perfectly curves to the top right? Just marveled at the beauty of this sign. Now, there is one exception here in Texas when we see this. Oh, we marvel. Oh, we're thankful. Bucky's, baby. I mean, it should be one of the wonders of the world, that the world comes and feels like everybody has come to Bucky's when you go there. Here's the difference. Art pieces are destinations. Signs are directions. Okay? Art pieces are destination. We go and we look at it and we behold the beauty in it. But signs are directions. They don't point to themselves. They point to something or someone better. They point to a reality that's outside of itself. So John, in the Gospel of John, does not use miracles. He uses signs because he wants you and I to know all of the miracles Jesus performed in and of themselves, they are not the destination. They are the directional signs. The destination is Jesus, and the miracles are directions, meaning the purpose of these signs is to clue you into the significance of who Jesus is. Signs are great, but the purpose of them is to point you to Jesus. Miracles are the directions. Jesus is the destination. Now, here at Bentry, let me tell you, we believe in miracles. We pray for them. We have seen many miracles. You have experienced the miracles of God in your life. But here's the reality. While we believe in miracles, we trust in Jesus. Yep. Right? We believe in miracles. We pray for them. But our trust is not in a miracle. Our trust is in Jesus. So if God does a miracle, man, we praise God, we shout, we give him thanks. If he doesn't give a miracle, we thank God, we praise and we shout, because our trust is never in a miracle. If our trust is in a miracle, then our faith will crumble if we don't see a miracle. But if our trust is in Jesus, we realize miracles are just one of the ways, one of the signs that point to the glory of God. Miracles are directions. Jesus is the destination. So John compiles for us seven signs. Seven is the number of completion, because he believes that these seven signs will lead you to the destination that is Jesus. In fact, here's his summary statement at the end of John, chapter 20, verse 30. Jesus performed many other signs, not miracles, signs, in the presence of his disciples that are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may believe. Here is the purpose of this gospel, and here is what I'm hoping for you if you're not yet a believer, flat out, that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. John, when he writes the Gospel of John, he's probably well into his 80s, maybe beyond. He's just a young man in his 80s and beyond. He has lived a lifetime of walking with Jesus as both his Savior and his friend. He's enjoyed the sweet fellowship with Jesus. But he has also experienced a life of pain and loss. Most of his fellow disciples are gone. They've been martyred in some way. He has seen the destruction of the temple of Jerusalem. He was there when Jesus himself was crucified. He has seen a lot of pain. He is seeing the unraveling of the Roman Empire right before his eyes. He has seen Nero, Emperor Nero, persecute and burn Christians alive as torches in the night sky. He's seen pain. He's seen the misery people are in, the questions that people are asking. And towards the end of his life, he is more convinced than ever that only by believing in Jesus can you have life. Only by trusting in Jesus can you have the life that you desperately need and want. That Jesus is the only one who can answer the deepest questions of your soul. He is the only one where your soul finds belonging and peace. So John says, I've compiled these seven signs because I want you to see his glory. And by seeing his glory, I want you to believe in him. And by believing in him, you will have life. So over the next 7 weeks, we're going to journey through one sign at a time, and particularly looking at what is it that John is revealing about who Jesus is through the sign. The miracle isn't in the sign, but it's what it's pointed to about Jesus. The first of the signs begins in a wedding, and the last of the seven signs ends at a funeral. It's a beautiful progression of Jesus turning water into wine and then raising the dead. In John 2, we find the first sign. As John records, on the third day, a wedding took place in Cana of Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples were invited to the wedding. Here Jesus is with a group, probably four or five of the earliest disciples of Jesus, with his mother, and this is near his hometown. This is in Cana. Now, first century weddings are different than today's weddings in many ways. One of the ways that it's different is weddings will last up to 7 days. Think about the expense bill on that one, right? 7 days. Here's the deal. Grooms had to pay for the wedding. Okay? Grooms had to pay the whole cost of the wedding. And this is first century. This is an honor and shame culture, which means that hospitality and reputation is king. Now, if you've gone to a wedding and the reception was subpar and the food ran out, you may be a little disappointed. But guess what? You're going to go through Chick-fil-A and get some food and you're good. I mean, all roads lead to Buc-ee's or Chick-fil-A. You're going to be fine. Like, you may complain a little bit, but that's the extent of your disappointment. But in first century, if the food was bad or if the wine ran out, this would be a huge deal. This would be public shame and humiliation. Why? Because hospitality was king. In fact, we have first century records of grooms being sued, literally in a lawsuit because the wine ran out. That's how serious it is. It would be the greatest dishonor and shame of their life, of the family's life. So notice the problem that we run into. Well, verse 3, the wine ran out. Somebody say, uh-oh. The wine ran out, and Jesus' mother told him they don't have any wine. Now we know Jesus' mother Mary, she is one of the few to know this problem because most likely she's on the inside, so this is probably a close relative, a friend, a close friend of Mary and Jesus. And so she is taking responsibility. She knows a problem that most people don't yet know. She's on the inside and she feels personally a need to solve the problem. Wine was the most common beverage in first century weddings. Now, here's the deal. As we read the rest of the story, spoiler alert, Jesus turns water into wine. Jesus doesn't turn water into grape juice. He actually does turn water into real wine. Okay, if you're a good Baptist, I just disappointed you. I'm so sorry. But hang in there. But the wine in first century was not like the wine today. This wine was highly diluted, okay, with water. They say the wine in first century was about 1/10 or 1/3, somewhere in between, of the level of concentration and fermentation of our wine today. So it was a highly diluted wine. And if you're Catholic, I just disappointed you because you're thinking, that's not real wine. Okay, I just disappointed everybody. Okay, but this is a scene. The wine has ran out. This could be day one or two of a 7-day celebration, and it's a major problem. And Mary is seeing the issue and she's thinking, my family member, my good friend is going to carry shame for the rest of their life because of this problem. So she does only that which she could think of, which is to go to Jesus. Jesus hasn't done any miracles that we know of yet. She knows Jesus is special, but she doesn't know that he's a miracle worker. Mary most likely by now already is a single mom. Jesus is her caretaker. He is providing for the family. And she knows that anytime I've needed something, anytime I have a need, I just got to go to Jesus. And I know him enough, I love him enough, I trust him enough to know that he'll do something about this problem. So Mary goes to Jesus and says, Jesus, we've got a problem. The wine has ran out. Now, notice Jesus' response. What has this concern of yours to do with me, woman? Okay, this is one of the few rare instances where you should not follow Jesus' example. It will not go well for you. Okay, there's actually a lot to unpack and why he calls Mary woman, but we don't have the time to unpack that, but it's really him drawing a distinction between Mary's request and his ultimate mission. His identity as Mary's son and his identity as a son of God. There's a beautiful thing happening here, but the secret, the key part of this whole conversation is the next verse. Jesus asked, the next phrase I'm in. Jesus asked, my hour has not yet come. My hour has not yet come. Now, for most of my adults, when I looked at that passage, I understood that as, okay, Jesus is saying, the time for me to do my first miracle hasn't yet come. Okay, maybe Jesus is saying, my season of miracle working isn't here yet. But that's actually not what I believe the statement means. Every time you see the phrase my hour used by Jesus in all the Gospels, he is referring to the cross. He's referring to the event on Good Friday, where he goes to Calvary and gives himself up as a price for our sins. And he becomes a perfect sacrifice, crucified on the cross. So every time Jesus says, my hour hasn't come or is coming, he's thinking directly about the cross. So if scripture interprets scripture, here when Jesus says to Mary, my hour hasn't come, he's not talking about the first miracle, he's thinking about his death. That actually makes this conversation even more weird. Think about it. Mary's like, Jesus, the wine's out. Jesus, woman, I'm not ready to die yet. What is going on, Jesus? So let me explain. At home, I actually really enjoy doing the dishes, okay? In ministry, you don't really get to check off a lot of the, okay, I've completed the job and it's just right. So I like doing stuff with my hands, whether it's reorganizing the garage or I used to mow the lawn until Stacey said I wasn't doing a good enough job, so she hired somebody. But I like to do the dishes so I can just check it off. And here's the deal. When I'm doing the dishes, do you know what's on my mind? Dishes. That's it. Just dishes, okay? When Stacey's doing the dishes, she is planning the next 5 years of our life, like vacations and our finances and all the to-do lists that I've got to do. She's just like, please don't do, let me do the dishes so that I don't come out with more work. She could be physically doing the dishes, but her mind is elsewhere. It's amazing. It's a gift. It's a spiritual gift. I don't know how she does it. I love you, babe. Okay, she's going to get me on this. I didn't tell her I was going to share this. Jesus is at the wedding. But his mind is at a different wedding. His mind is at the wedding he will have with the church of Jesus, the bride of Christ. Here's what I think. Jesus in this wedding is thinking about the ultimate divine wedding, not an earthly wedding, but a divine wedding. And he's thinking about he being the groom who has to pay the price, to foot the bill. And the price is his blood. The price is his life. The price is the cross. It's Jesus' body hanging on a cross. That's why at the Last Supper, when Jesus is having the Passover meal, he took the cup of what? Wine. And he said to his disciples, this is my blood, the blood of the new covenant poured out for many. The wine is the blood. And when Mary comes and says, the wine has run out, Jesus is thinking about his blood, which be the wine of the new covenant. He says, yeah, I know the wine's run out, but it's not yet time for me to accomplish the mission of dying on the cross. He's thinking about the cross. We got another clue that this is maybe what is on Jesus' mind. As John says in verse 13, right after this miracle, the Jewish Passover was near. And also Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Jesus is beginning his ministry right at the time of the Passover because he's going to end his earthly ministry on Passover. He's starting his ministry thinking about the end. And the end is his hour, which will come, which is the cross of Jesus. Jesus is unsettled by Mary's request, but not so because what she's asking, because he's going to do that. He's unsettled because he's thinking about the price of his blood that will be shed for the forgiveness of our sins. So Mary, she doesn't seem overly offended by Jesus' response. So she tells her servants, just do whatever he tells you. Whatever he says, do it. It'll be good for you. Just do whatever he says. And that's what happens. John 2, verse 6, Jesus says to the servants, now, 6 stone water jars had been set there for Jewish purification. Each contained 20 or 30 gallons. Now, in Jewish homes and in Jewish functions, they would have these massive stone jars, which were religious, ritualistic symbols. They were filled with water. And Jews had a heightened view of God's holiness and their sinfulness. And they would constantly wash themselves in these jars or with these jars of water. They knew it didn't clean them on the inside, but at least they could feel clean on the outside. So they would repeatedly wash themselves, purify themselves. It was their religious system. It was a religious tradition of how to feel clean, at least on the inside, when you know you're not clean on the inside, to feel clean on the outside. And so Jesus points to that thing that they have been looking at and trusting and then going to, this man-made system of purification, hoping that it would cleanse them. And he tells, hey, fill these jars with water. 20 to 30 gallons. See, so 120 to 180 gallons of wine that's about to be produced. Thought about Jesus throwing a party, right? Massive. And so they do. And it's amazing that they do. Verse 7. Fill the jars with water, Jesus told them. So they did. This may be the first time that they meet Jesus. He hasn't done a single miracle. They're going to probably look foolish at thinking, but they do it anyway. Talk about the faith. They filled it not just halfway, but to the brim. And then he said to them, now draw some out and take it to the head waiter. And they did. What a bold thing to do. And when the head waiter tasted the water after it had become wine, he did know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. We don't know when it became wine. It could have been as they were pouring it out. It could have been as they're walking to the table. We don't know. But he called the groom and told him, everyone sets out the fine wine first, and then after people are drunk, the inferior. But you have kept the fine wine until now. You've kept the best. It's the best I've ever tasted. It is so unlike the normal patterns of our culture, so unlike the normal patterns of wedding. They start off good and they go bad, but you've kept the best. And notice how John concludes this story, this event. Jesus did this, the first of his signs, not miracle signs. This was the first of his directional signs in Cana of Galilee, not Jerusalem, not in a big city, but in Cana. And what did he do? He revealed his glory. It was a sign that revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. His disciples, they saw this as something so glorious, something so magnificent, then said, we believe in Jesus because he has just turned water into wine. Now, if this isn't just a miracle, but it is a sign, if this event is not just a destination, but a direction, we've got to ask ourselves, what does Jesus want us to know from this first sign at this wedding in Cana? What's our takeaway from this moment? Pastor and author Anthony Salvaggio, he described this first sign as the fall of the Berlin Wall on November 9th, I think 1989. The symbolism of the fall of the Berlin Wall was that an old era was coming to an end and a new era was beginning. It symbolized the collapse of communism and the termination of the Cold War. It was the end of an era and the dawning of a new era. And Jesus, in this first miracle, first sign, is announcing to the world that a new era was dawning. In fact, Jesus is inaugurating a new spiritual order that changes everything. He's saying the systems of man-made religion are no longer going to work. Being ruled by laws and traditions and purification systems, they're coming to an end. That era worked for a certain time. It served its purpose, but now a new era is inbreaking into the world. It is coming into the world. A new order is being inaugurated here in Cana. Let me quiz you. For those of you Bible nerds, which was the first plague in Egypt? Water being turned into blood. It was the first sign by which Pharaoh would see the glory of God. And it was the first of 10 plagues that would release Pharaoh's grip on the Israelites. And they would come out of 400 years of slavery and oppression. And the first sign that God did in Egypt was to turn the water in the Nile into blood. It was the end of the era of their slavery and the beginning of their freedom, marked by turning water into blood. Jesus is signifying, I am beginning the era of spiritual freedom. Freedom from sin, freedom from slavery, freedom from death, freedom from Satan himself. And if Moses turned water into blood, Jesus would turn water into wine, wine which represents his blood. You get it? Wine which says the blood is the end result. The blood is a means of our freedom. So Jesus is saying, and a new order is coming. And Moses was used by God as a deliverer, but now we have the deliverer himself coming to usher in a new spiritual order of freedom and grace. And that's why Jesus pointed to these jars used for Jewish purification. Jesus was saying, it's not just the wine at this wedding that's running out, but the power of religion is running out. The wine of self-help and the wine of trying to get to God on your own, the wine of our own systems and trying to be good enough and cleanse ourselves, that can only cleanse you on the outside, but it can't cleanse you inside. But I am beginning a journey where through my blood, you will be cleansed from the inside out. From the depths of your soul, you are going to be made new. Amen? That's why Paul says it in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, not if you've been purified by the jars of water, not if you've offered the perfect sacrifice or done the right things or believed in the right thing. No, no. If anyone is in Christ, he or she is a new creation. The old has passed, and see, the new has come. You're here because just as Jesus changed water into wine, he's changed you, hasn't he? Hasn't he brought real change or transformation? Erased you of your guilt, freed you from sin, freed you from addiction, took you from being children of wrath into children of light, from the domain, the kingdom of darkness into his magnificent light. He's taken us who were enemies of God and now made us family, children of God. He has done the sign over and over again. Every one of your testimony would tell us, here's how I used to be, but here's who I am, because if anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. A new order has come, not by religious systems or traditions, but through the grace and forgiveness that is given to us through the blood of Jesus that was shed. Jesus could have picked any one of the signs to start his ministry. I think I would have chosen raising Lazarus from the dead. I would have made a huge statement. But Jesus didn't do that. He purposely chose a wedding because that wedding beautifully depicts his relationship with us. He chose a young couple, probably poor, didn't have the means to provide enough food and drink. And what does he do? He comes in, does a miracle, and he removes their shame. And he brings joy. Because that's what Jesus does in the gospel. Who does the work? He. Whose shame is removed? Ours. He does the miracle of salvation, and it's our shame that's removed. He turns water into wine, but we are the beneficiaries. And Jesus is saying, I'm here to replace your lack, your shame, with abundance and joy in me, that you can have the new wine, gallons full of my joy, my presence. I am the new wine you need. Christianity is not just a set of beliefs that we ascribe to and chuck off. It is a cause for joy because your shame, my shame, has been removed completely. And we, who are an embarrassment to God, have been made children of God, and his righteousness and honor has been placed on you fully. Come on, give God some praise. It's new wine. Do you remember on the day of Pentecost, 120 are in the upper room? They get filled with the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues and all. What are they accused of? Being drunk on wine. The onlookers, the Jews, are saying, these guys are drunk on wine. And Peter's got to get up and correct them, saying, no, it's only 9 in the morning. We're not drunk on wine, but we're drunk of the new wine, the Holy Spirit of God, who has filled us with joy. He has filled us with his Spirit. God drenched the early disciples with fresh wine, the Spirit of God. If you're a believer in Jesus, you ought to be the most joyful. People ought to think you're drunk all the time. But it's not something that leads to a lack of sobriety, but to sobriety. Something that gives you the most clear vision of life and of God and of joy. We're drunk in the Spirit of God, the new wine. A question worth asking is, what is the real wine of your life? Like the real cause of joy, the real form of sustenance for you. What is it? Is it a career? Is it a hobby? Is it a relationship? Is it a job? For some of you, it's literally wine. And you turn to a bottle to ease your mind, to remove your pain, and numb your feelings. Take this message from the head waiter who said, you know, every party I've been to, the wine goes from good to bad. What he's saying is, the world's wine always goes from good to bad. It may start off feeling good, but it always turns worse. And guess what? It will always run out. It'll leave you empty. It'll leave you dry. You run after him or her, after that thing, whatever it is. You thinking, that's the source of my joy. That's what defines me. That's what gives me joy. It will always run out, and it will turn deeply sour and horrible before it runs out. But the wine that Jesus gives starts off the best and only gets better. And it never runs out. It is living water for your soul. It gives you real meaning, real joy, real purpose. It is what you most desperately need, the new wine that Jesus gives us. There's a second application that I think this wedding points us to, and it's simply the fact that Jesus is preparing a future wedding banquet, that this wedding shows us that there is a wedding coming. Now, I think some people are saying the rapture's coming tomorrow. I don't know. It could be today for all I know. But Jesus is coming one day, and you and I are the bride of Jesus, spotless, perfect, righteous in Jesus. We are his bride. And Jesus is saying, you are invited. Blessed are those, John would say in Revelation, blessed are those who are invited to the wedding supper of the Lamb. Friends, you are not a sinner that Jesus or God barely tolerates. You are his bride that he delights in. You are his bride that he delights in. I want you to look at these beautiful imageries in the Old Testament and New that draw for us the wedding supper of the Lamb, our union with Jesus. And notice the theme of wine in all of them. Joel 3:18, in that day, the mountains will drip with sweet wine and the hills will flow with milk. Mountains are dripping with sweet wine, meaning his joy never runs out. Every other wine will run out, but this one only compounds and gets more and more. Now, the next imagery, if you're a vegan, this is not a scripture you may enjoy. But for those of us who love meat, this is a beautiful passage of scripture to hang on to. Isaiah 25, verse 6, on this mountain, the Lord of armies will prepare for all the peoples a feast of choice meat. Amen. A feast with aged wine. Hallelujah. Prime cuts of choice meat. Let's go, Fogo de Chão. Fine vintage wine. I love the rest of this passage. On this mountain, he will swallow up the burial shroud, the shroud over all the peoples, the sheet covering all the nations. When the Lord, when he has swallowed up death once and for all, the Lord God will wipe away the tears from every face and remove his people's disgrace from the whole earth. For the Lord has spoken. On that day, it will be said, look, this is our God. We have waited for him, and he has saved us. This is the Lord. We have waited for him. So let's rejoice and be glad in his salvation. Let's rejoice and be glad in his salvation. That's the wedding you've been invited to. So Jesus, when he took the cup of the wine, he said, I'm not going to drink this again, this fruit of the vine, until you and I are together in the kingdom. There is a wedding coming. And you are invited. And for those of us who are in Christ, we've already said yes, and our RSVP is secured. But for the rest of us, this is the moment to do what Mary and the servants did, Simply trust in Jesus. Mary said, whatever he does, just do. Whatever he says, just do it. The servants, they went against every bit of their human intuition. And they said, if Jesus said it, we're going to do it. Would you place your faith, confidence in Jesus? He will never tell you to do something that robs your joy, but only gives you real life and real meaning. And he's inviting you and I, trust me. I'm bringing in a new order of peace, forgiveness, and grace. And one day you and I are going to be reunited. And you will see that following the direction of all the signs of Jesus was so well worth it. Because we will for all of eternity stand and marvel at the destination who's none other than Jesus, the Son of God, full of glory. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for these signs preserved for us so that it moves us in the direction of believing, cherishing, delighting in Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for bringing in a new order, not dependent on human systems or own jars of purification, but fully on the grace of Jesus, where the work you do removes our shame. We want to live in the abundance of joy. We want to be a people who are living with one foot in this world and one foot in the eternal wedding banquet of God. Full of joy, may we be known as a people marked by celebration because we have tasted and we have seen that the Lord is good. Thank you, Jesus. Today, if there is someone who isn't yet to place their faith in you, may they see the glory of Jesus in this first sign of how you change the water into wine, and you are saying, I can make you new. I can change everything about you, your past, present, and future, if you would simply trust in me. May it be the day that faith is birthed in the hearts of hundreds. In Jesus' name we pray, and the church said together, amen. 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 Can we give Jesus a Thanksgiving of praise for his word?